difficult things about what I talk about is get people to drop their preconceived notions, their preconceived ideas, their it can't be happening, this is impossible, to drop those kinds of obstacles and just take a look at the evidence. And maybe, just maybe, what I'm all about is just maybe you will see or hear something here today that's going to convince you that something is terribly wrong. And it's going to empower you to become active and help us find out exactly what is wrong and fix it. Because I believe that we don't have too much time left to do this. I hope that I'm wrong. I sincerely hope that I'm wrong. But I have to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, since I have begun telling the world what I know and what I've found in my research, thousands of people have set out to intentionally prove me wrong, to ridicule me, to discredit me, to do all of these things, and no one has succeeded.
Hello. My name is Keith Thompson, and I am an independent investigative researcher, and I have devoted my life to researching the truth about our world. If you are a Fox News watcher or a CNN watcher who only believes what is on TV, this film is not for you.
Hillary voted.
Hillary watching tonight. You just got an endorsement.
I just heard the word no.
I was touched when she cried.
If you are a Bush supporter, a Clinton supporter, a McCain supporter, or an Obama supporter, this film is not for you. If you question the versions of reality we are presented with, be it from the media or the government, this film is for you. I have done many debates, I have debunked part one of Zeitgeist, and I'm a Christian. But this film is bound to open up anyone's eyes who watches it. This film is going to expose the Satanic Empire that controls the world. We will be looking at the Illuminati, the New World Order, cults, the plan to destroy Christianity, Freemasonry, and the Vatican. Before we begin, it is absolutely crucial that you understand what it is that I do. I expose the unsugar-coated truth, but at the same time, I give people hope, and God is on our side. If you are an atheist, I'm just letting you know, right now, that you have fallen for the great deception from the New World Order. In this film, I hope to wake people up, as many as possible. By doing this, I have already sealed my fate, so spread this video around to everyone you know. What you are looking at is the elite of the world, including Bush, Clinton, Rockefeller, Kissinger, politicians and royalty from everywhere, participating in a satanic ritual in front of a 50-foot stone idol. These are the elite, dressed up in red, black, and white robes, doing a sacrifice, getting rid of their conscience or care. This is what we are dealing with, but that's nothing compared to what these people's goals are. It's called a New World Order, One World Government, leaving us with no freedom, and microchipped or tagged like animals. This plan has been around for generations, but time has run out, and now they are making big moves to achieve their goal. The reason I made this film is to wake up the public from the mass hypnosis the media has on them. Many of you know what I'm talking about, but even you guys will learn something today. During the Bush presidency, there has been a mass awakening in America, and the statistics show that people are waking up slowly. This film will seal the deal, and I hope everybody references it when convincing your friends and loved ones of this truth. This is not a game, this is very serious, and my life, like Cooper's, and many before me, is in jeopardy for releasing this information. The story begins in Bavaria on May 1st, 1776. May 1st is now the satanic holiday of Beltane. Adam Weishaupt, Anton von Musenhausen, Mertz Tiberius, Franz Xaver Zwack, and Adolf Baron von Nisch formed the Order of the Illuminati. Weishaupt's philosophy was that the Illuminati should rule the world. Adam Weishaupt said the following, quote, "The great strength of our order lies in its concealment. Let it never appear in any place in its own name, but by another name and another activity. None is fitter than Freemasonry. The public is accustomed to it, expect little from it, and therefore takes little notice of it." Unquote. So it was said. They would infiltrate Freemasonry to achieve their goal. The one who helped Weishaupt gain admission into lodges was Adolf Baron von Nisch. Adolf attained the highest degree of the Knights Templar, the Cypric Knight, in 1777 at Hanau. Here's a depiction of a Knights Templar initiation ritual. From late 1777 and onward, Weishaupt and his order infiltrated Masonic lodges all over Belgium, Austria, France, Holland, Denmark, Sweden, Poland, Hungary, and Italy. One of Weishaupt's first initiates, Louis Philip Joseph, Duke of Orleans, had already been initiated into the French Grand Lodge, and according to Mackey's encyclopedia, he was elected Grand Master in 1773 upon the death of Count de Clermont. Weishaupt stated that the plan for the New World Order could not successfully be executed in any other way than through secret societies that gradually and quietly took over government. The Illuminati gained significant control on July 16, 1782, at the Masonic Congress of Wilhelmsbad. This meeting included Masons from all over Europe and Illuminati members such as von Nisch. Here the Illuminati spread their doctrine and promoted their ideology. This allowed them to solidify their control over Masonic lodges of Europe and to be viewed as the leaders of the occult One World Movement. The Congress was held at Mayor Amschel Rothschild's castle in Wilhelmsbad. The Congress included representatives of all secret societies, Martinists as well as Freemasons and Illuminati. This historian Nesta Webster tells us this: "Those in the Congress were under oath to reveal nothing. One such Mason, Comte de Verie, a member of the Martinist Lodge at Lyons, returning from the Congress could not conceal his alarm, and when questioned on the tragic secrets, he had brought back with him this reply, quote, 'I will not confide them to you. I can only tell you that this is very much more serious than you think. The conspiracy which is being woven is so well thought out that it will be, so to speak, impossible for the monarchy and the church to escape it.' That's from his biographer M. Costa Begerard." In Mackey's Encyclopedia of Freemasonry, page 346 and 347, he says, quote, "The order was very popular and enrolled no less than 2,000 names upon its register, among whom were some of the most distinguished men of Germany. It extended rapidly into other countries, and its lodges were to be found in France, Belgium, Holland, Denmark, Sweden, Poland, Hungary, and Italy," unquote. As the order grew very powerful in Europe, patriotic ruler Duke Karl Theodore came to power in Bavaria. He issued a ban against all secret societies in Bavaria. For this reason, on July 20, 1785, Franz George Lang was struck by lightning and died on a courier route with instructions from Weishaupt about the planned French Revolution addressed to the Grand Master of the Grand Orient in Paris. Everything was handed over to the Bavarian government. On August 4th, a new ban on secret societies was issued. On February 11th, Weishaupt was discharged and forbidden to live in Ingolstadt or Munich. On February 16th, he went underground and was hidden by his Illuminati brother, Joseph Martin. A few days later, he fled to Nuremberg for a short while, and then traveled to the free city of Rothenburg, where he continued his activities underground. Although the Bavarian government arrested as many Illuminati members as they could possibly find, and even had four testify exposing the satanic nature of its aims, by this point the Illuminati so thoroughly enmeshed itself into Freemasonry across Europe, there was no telling where Illuminism ended and Freemasonry began. The documents that were seized by the Bavarian government were sent to all European leaders to warn them, but there was a failure to heed warning. Some of the European leaders had already fallen under the influence of the Illuminati, and others found it just too difficult to believe. Many people believe that it was at this time that the Illuminati was effectively disbanded and stopped in 1785, but that's not what the evidence points to. We know from credible sources that the Illuminati spread all over Europe and got no less than 3,000 members, so how could the Bavarian government control that? It doesn't make sense. Adam Weishaupt succeeded at forging an alliance between Illuminized Freemasonry and the growing Rothschild child banking network. This gave the Order the means to carry out its plans and to multiply its influence. That's Nesta Webster World Revolution, page 20, and Count Egan Caesar Corti, The Rise of the House of Rothschild, page 10. As a result of the alliance with the Rothschilds, the Illuminati grew, it took root, it flourished, it gathered itself more men of royal and noble titles, even the Jesuits joined. The Rothschilds had played a major role in the Bavarian Illuminati, hosting the Masonic Congress of Wilhelmsbad. When Amschel Rothschild died, headship fell onto Nathan Rothschild of England. The bloodline continued to infiltrate lodges in England. He was initiated into London's Lodge of Emulation, Fritz Springmeier Bloodlines of the Illuminati. Karl Rothschild became leader in 1818. An Alta Vendetta document that Karl prepared was sent to the headquarters of Masonry. A copy of the document was lost and the Masons were upset and offered a reward for the return of the document. It was called Practical Code of Rules, Guide for the Heads of the Highest Grades of Freemasonry. James Rothschild spread his family to France. James was a 33rd degree Scottish Rite. Fritz Springmeier, Bloodlines of the Illuminati. Thirteen years after the Illuminati supposedly stopped, Reverend G.W. Snyder wrote George Washington a letter, August 22, 1798. He says, quote, "A society of Freemasons that distinguished itself by the name of Illuminati, whose plan is to overthrow all government and religion. It might be within your power to prevent the horrid plan from corrupting these English lodges over which you preside," unquote. Here's the original manuscript sources of George Washington's writings from the U.S. Government Printing Office. In response to Snyder's letter, Washington writes, quote, "I have heard much of the nefarious and dangerous plan and doctrines of the Illuminati. It is not my intention to doubt that the doctrine of the Illuminati and the principles of Jacobinism had not spread in the United States. On the contrary, no one is more truly satisfied of this fact than I am." So what he's saying is, you don't have to tell me about the Illuminati and what they're doing in New York, I already know. When he says he's satisfied, that does not mean he's happy about it. In that old English context, it means he's convinced of it. So no one is more convinced than I am. Then he says, and I'm going to paraphrase for you because it's in old English. He says, "The idea that I meant to convey was that I did not believe that the lodges of the Freemasons in this country had, as societies, endeavored to propagate the diabolical tenets of the first, the Illuminati, or the pernicious principles of the latter, the Jacobins, but that there are individuals in the Masonic order who may have done this." So he's saying that no whole lodge in America is involved in this as a whole society, but individuals in the lodges may be, or that the founder or instruments employed to found the democratic societies in the United States, later known as the Democratic Party, may have had these objects in mind, and actually had the separation of the people from their government in view is too evident to be questioned. So what he's saying is, he knows of the Illuminati's plans, they are real, no whole lodge is involved in it in America yet, but individuals in the lodges probably are, and the Democratic Party was founded by a secret society of Masons that want to divide the people from their government, and it's too evident to be questioned. Joseph Willard, president of Harvard in 1812, said, quote, "There is sufficient evidence that a number of societies of the Illuminati have been established in this land. They are doubtless trying to secretly undermine all our ancient institutions, civil and sacred. The enemies of all order are seeking our ruin. Should they prevail, our independence would fall, of course. A republican government would be annihilated." The U.S. State Department began a close relationship with the Grand Orient of France in the late 1930s. Marshal Henri Philippe Pétain was against Freemasonry. He closed down the Grand Orient in 1940. He then forced legislation demanding the disbanding of all secret societies. Masons were forced to either resign from their posts or from their lodges. Pétain was a traitor, and he was working with the German army, providing them with large food supplies and manufactured goods. Pétain had a total of 5,000 Masons arrested. He took the opportunity to confiscate the archives of the Freemasons, which were handed to the German government. The Freemasons took their revenge on Pétain in 1945 when he was sentenced to life in prison for treason. So with the help of Pétain, the Germans had the powerful French Grand Orient archives, but not for long. After a grueling and bloody battle, the Soviets had their way with Germany, and in 1945 at Castle of Alten in Niederschlossen, the Red Army came across 25 large German railway cars containing the powerful French Grand Orient archives. The documents gave a comprehensive picture of the secret power wielded by international Freemasonry. The information in the documents contained important details about the Masonic conspiracy for a New World Order, One World Government with the West. With the aid of the secret Masonic archives, Stalin was able to blackmail several Western Masonic politicians who feared exposure. Even the pro-Masonic magazine, Freemasonry Today, Autumn 2001 edition, talks about the same thing. Quote, on June 14, 1940, the German army entered Paris and on the same day took control of the buildings of the Grand Orient de France. At Rue Cadet, situated in the center of the city, German military intelligence officers also paid a visit to the homes of the Masons. On July 1, 1940, the German Foreign Minister Alfred Rosenberg informed Martin Bormann that, quote, the great treasures had been discovered in occupied Masonic premises. Teams were established to seize documents relating to the workings of the Grand Orient, the largest organized body of French Freemasonry. They seized valuable historical documents specifically targeting files covering the Grand Orient's external relations from the middle of the 19th century. Stalin's victorious Red Army later transferred them to Moscow's special central state archives, where their very existence remained a state secret. It was not until after the fall of the communist regime in 1990 that an American researcher, Kennedy Grimstead, revealed their existence. After prolonged negotiations, the archives were successfully returned to France. According to the Grand Orient's librarian, Pierre Molière, this was like Christmas many times over. Illuminized Masonic symbolism is all over America. On the back of the dollar bill on the left-hand side above the pyramid, it says Anuit Coeptus, which means our enterprise is now a success, or a crowned success. So what enterprise does it mean? Well, Novus Ordo Seclorum near the bottom. Novus meaning new, Ordo is order, Seclorum is where we get our word secular, meaning the world. So it means new order of the world, simply new world order. So what it's saying is the new world order is now a crowned success. This was put on the dollar bill in 1934. 1934 is when the Federal Reserve took total control of the United States monetary system. The Fed is essentially controlled by two Illuminati bloodlines, the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers. President Franklin D. Roosevelt, a 32nd degree Scottish Rite Mason, placed the seal on the dollar bill. Roosevelt was also in the Order of the Nobles of the Mystic Shrine, known for its satanic rituals. The pyramid has 13 steps. In fact, the number 13 is on the bill everywhere. 13 leaves on the olive branch, 13 berries, 13 stripes on the shield, 13 arrows, 13 stars, 13 letters on E Pluribus Unum, and 13 letters in Anuit Coeptus. Now some people believe 13 is on the bill due to the 13 colonies, but dig a little bit deeper and you'll find the real answer. The 13 colony explanation is subliminal indirect reverse psychological propaganda. That's how these people do things. We must go back to the first occurrence of the number 13 in order to discover its key significance. It occurs first in Genesis 14 verse 4. It says, 12 years they served Chedorlaomer, and in the 13th year they rebelled. These people are rebelling against the divine natural order, and Adam Weishaupt was a rebel as well. The other half of the meaning comes from Fritz Springmeier. 13 also represents the 13 top Illuminati families that he traced back to the late 18th century and the early 19th century. He is credible, and that's why he was framed by the government and thrown in a cage. 1776 is in Roman numerals near the bottom. Some think it's because of the founding of the country. Another case of subliminal indirect reverse psychological propaganda. 1776 is when the Illuminati was formed. The New World Order. Another striking fact is that the eagle has 32 feathers on the right wing, the number of ordinary degrees of the Scottish Rite. There's 33 feathers on the left wing, representing the 33rd degree. The tail has 9 feathers, which represents the 9th degree of the York Rite. The eagle itself is a prominent icon in Masonry, extensively used in the Scottish Rite. Here is your average Freemasonic enter apprentice initiation ritual caught on a hidden camera. But then later, something more nefarious. They're standing and sitting around a pentagram. These are your Freemasons. They have a goat on the pentagram, and they're doing a satanic sacrifice, draining the blood of the goat into a bucket. You can see them cutting the neck. Now, if you have family members that are Freemasons, do not be alarmed of this video. This probably doesn't happen at the Blue Lodge, the first, second, or third degree. This is most likely a 33rd degree ritual. These people use symbolism and code to communicate with each other, showing their dominance over the world. You'll notice that the pyramid and the all-seeing eye on the dollar bill is the exact same as the British Intelligence Service, MI5. This is a display of power. They're saying they control these two countries. Thus, they control the world. Now, one of the satanic Illuminati families that controls the world are the Rockefellers. In 1921, David Rockefeller founded the Council on Foreign Relations, which is the promotional arm of the ruling elite in the US. This is meant to control the US from behind the scenes. Now, David Rockefeller wrote a book called Memoirs in 2002. He said something striking. He said, quote, "We wield over American political and economical institutions. Some even believe we are part of a secret cabal working against the best interests of the United States, characterizing my family and me as internationalists, and of conspiring with others around the world to build a more integrated global political structure, one world if you will. If that's the charge, I stand guilty, and I'm proud of it." David Rockefeller was the co-founder and is the honorary chairman of the infamous Trilateral Commission. In June 1991, addressing the Trilateral Commission, David Rockefeller said the following: "We are grateful to the Washington Post, the New York Times, Time Magazine, and other great publications whose directors have attended our meetings and respected their promises of discretion for almost 40 years. It would have been impossible for us to develop our plan for the world if we had been subject to the bright lights of publicity during those years. But the world is now much more sophisticated and prepared to march towards world government." Co-founder of the Trilateral Commission, Bilderberg attendee, and high-ranking Freemason of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, Zbigniew Brzezinski, said the following in 1970, quote, "I have no doubt that the world government will appear in our lifetime. The necessary requirements for final globalization is a continuous regionalization, because that way we move toward larger, more stable, and more cooperative units," unquote. These people are Illuminati, and they all have a common goal, which is a one-world government fascist system.
If you've ever heard any of our call-in shows, you know that we have people that think about the conspiracy theories of people like you. You would be a poster child for these people because you have served on the board of the Council on Foreign Relations. You helped start the Trilateral Commission, and you've been to the Bilderberg groups.
At the Bilderberg meeting in Badan, June 6th through 9th, 1991, which saw the debut of Bill Clinton, who was virtually unknown at this time outside of Arkansas, had spent 3 days with the Rockefellers and the elite, and then barely 2 months later he had been nominated as presidential candidate for the Democrats, and another 16 months later he was president of the United States of America. Talk about corruption. The Bilderberg meetings were started by Joseph Hernum Redinger, a 33rd degree Freemason. In 1955, he started the European Community Initiative, which ultimately led to the EU. Now, during the 1980s, the Freemason Romano Prodi was a member of the Bilderberg Steering Committee. In 1999, he was appointed President of the European Commission. High-ranking Freemason José Manuel Barroso was in spring 2004 appointed new President of the European Commission.
Sometimes I like to compare the European Union as a creation to the organization of empires. The empires.
Freemason Wim Duesenberg was treasurer of Bilderberg since 1982. In 2004, he was appointed head of the European Central Bank. On November 18, 2002, the EU Commission announced that the 10 new member states would be admitted on May 1st of the year. May 1st was the day the Illuminati started, May 1st, 1776. People who are in positions to recognize the elements of Satanism have noticed the similarities between Satanism and Freemasonry. Anton Sander LaVey, the founder of the Church of Satan, wrote a book called The Satanic Rituals. LaVey describes the nefarious satanic ritual known as the Ceremony of the Stifling Air. He notes that the exact same ritual is embodied in the Nobles of the Mystic Shrine, and I quote, "The original Templars' rite of the fifth degree symbolically guided their candidate through the Devil's Pass, in the mountains separating east from west. At the fork of the trail, the candidate would make an important decision where he might dwell in Satan's household. A striking American parallel to this rite is enacted within the Order of the Nobles of the Mystic Shrine, an order reserved for 32nd degree Freemasons. The nobles have gracefully removed themselves from any implication of hearsay by referring to the place beyond the Devil's Pass as the Dominion where they might worship the Shrine of Islam," unquote. The Satanic Rituals, page 56. To be a Freemason, you have to swear oaths of secrecy in your rituals. The penalties for breaking the oaths are horrible. Enter apprentice or first degree swears if he breaks his oath, he will get his throat slit from ear to ear and tongue torn out by the roots, and then your body buried. Second degree or fellowcraft is getting your heart cut out and then your body getting fed to wild beasts. Third degree or master mason is having your body severed in two, then having your body burned to ashes. While Aleister Crowley was writing about satanic sacrifice, child abuse, and bestiality, he was being awarded the highest degrees of Freemasonry. He was more than just a 33rd degree Scottish Rite Mason. He rose to the 97th degree of the Rite of Memphis and Mizraim. Crowley's disturbing practices of bestiality, child sacrifice, and ritual abuse earned him the reputation of the wickedest man alive, but this didn't stop the flood of Masonic honors that were heaped upon him. He said, quote, "I possess more exalted titles than I have ever been able to count. I am supposed to know more secret signs, tokens, grips, passwords, and grand words than I could learn in a dozen lives. An elephant would break down under the insignia I am entitled to wear," unquote. The Confessions of Aleister Crowley, page 684 and 685. Now, Crowley also wrote about bloody sacrifices in his book Magic in Theory and Practice, page 95, instructing the reader that, quote, "The animal should therefore be killed within the circle, or the triangle, as the case may be, so that the energy cannot escape. But the bloody sacrifice, though more dangerous, is more efficacious, and for nearly all purposes, human sacrifice is the best. A male child of perfect innocence and high intelligence is the most satisfying and suitable victim." Sometimes whole lodges are satanic. For example, the Grand Orient d'Italia rented Palazzo Borghese in Rome in 1893. 2 years later, due to a dispute about the rent contract, the Freemasons had to vacate parts of the palace. The representative of the owner, the Duke of Borghese, undertook an inspection. The newspaper courier Nazinal stated that the room was locked. The inspectors had to threaten to bring police before they were allowed to enter the room. The whole room had been converted into a shrine to Satan. The walls were covered with red and black silk, and a tapestry with a woven depiction of the devil was on the wall. Now, some ignorant Freemasons will claim that the oaths are only symbolic and that you will never get killed for talking about the lodge, but that's not the case. Roberto Calvi was a P2 Lodge Freemason. He was also manager and chief owner of the Ambrosiano Bank. On June 18, 1982, he was found hanged beneath Blackfriars Bridge on the Thames in London, 4 miles from Chelsea Cloister where he was staying. The official verdict published by Scotland Yard was suicide. In addition, it was concluded that he had first been strangled. Kelvey, called God's banker, had just prior threatened to expose the P2 role in the bank crash. Later on, the ordinary police took over the investigation and concluded that it was murder. The day before Kelvey's death, his secretary, Grisela Kurocher, quote, threw herself out of her window of the fourth floor of the bank. And on October 2nd, 1982, another bank employee, Giuseppe Pelluccia, jumped out of the window of the bank and committed quote-unquote suicide. On October 5th, 2005, five people were charged with Kelvey's murder. On June 6, 2007, all five were cleared by the court of murdering Kelvey due to insufficient evidence. The court ruled that it was murder, not suicide, but no one was sentenced. Now, one of the most vicious Masonic presidents of the US was Harry S. Truman. He was Scottish Rite, York Rite, Knights Templar, and he was Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Missouri, 33rd degree. In a radio speech in 1941, Truman said, quote, George Washington built the U.S. on Masonic principles, and I want to continue the same spirit, unquote. On February 22, 1946, Grand Master Truman went to the American United Lodge and took an oath to govern the country on Masonic principles. He said, quote, my work is built on Masonic principles. I believe that these leadership principles must be spread all over the world, unquote. So how did Master Truman then spread his Masonic principles? He committed ritual mass murder on Japan when in 1945 he gave the order to annihilate hundreds of thousands of innocent people, vaporizing Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the only Christian city in Japan. The atomic bomb called Little Boy hit Hiroshima, immediately turning it into ash and ruin, killing 240,000 people. Truman was very happy when informed of the ritual mass killing of thousands of innocent people. He pronounced it was, quote, an overwhelming success. It would have been sufficient enough to demonstrate the devastating effect of the bomb to Japanese ambassadors in a test in the US deserts. An American medical station was set up in Hiroshima. Its only task was to document the symptoms of the victims. No treatment was given whatsoever. According to Tony Benn of the British government, Japan was wanting to surrender long before the bombs were dropped. And according to William D. Leahy, in his book I Was There, page 441, Japan was willing to surrender in spring of 1945. But Truman was not interested. The Truman administration consisted solely of Freemasons.
Having found the atomic bomb, we have used it. We shall continue to use it. Only a Japanese surrender will stop us.
Now, the elite of the world, such as Bilderbergers, high-level Masons, CFR attendees, and Trilateral Commission attendees, all meet up with each other once a year at a place called the Bohemian Grove. The Grove is a 2,700-acre secluded area in the woods of Montreal, California. The fact is, there is irrefutable evidence that satanic ritual goes on inside the Bohemian Grove. Here is a photo of Masonic coffin ritual being performed in front of a shrine of the devil. Now, a documentary filmmaker and radio talk show host from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones, snuck into the Bohemian Grove in the year 2000 and filmed this satanic ritual, known as the cremation of care. Notice the 50-foot stone idol. Notice the red, black, and white robes. Notice the fire and the satanic sacrifice. Now, there's a debate on what the idol represents. One camp says it's Moloch, the god of child sacrifice in the Old Testament, due to the nature of the ritual and the sacrifice near the belly of the idol. But in my research, I found that it is not actually Moloch. The owl is a symbol of Minerva. You see, Dionysus of ancient Greece is interchangeable with Apollo, and Apollo's counterpart is Athena and Minerva, whose symbol is the owl. Similarly, child sacrifice was also involved in this cult. The owl became an important Illuminati symbol in 1776 and was adapted to the name of the Illuminati degree known as Minervals. In A. Beryl's book, Memoirs Illustrating the History of Jacobinism, published in 1798, page 582, he writes, quote, Vicept had adopted the bird of the night as his emblem, unquote. The owl represents wisdom, so what the elite are doing here is sacrificing something to Minerva, the owl of wisdom, and at the same time getting rid of their conscience and their care. Genesis 2:9 tells us that the tree of knowledge, to which the deceitful serpent falsely attributed the power of imparting the superior kind of knowledge, beyond that which God was pleased to give. So the elite want the knowledge that God is not willing to give them. and they are willing to do satanic sacrifice to the false god of wisdom, the owl Minerva, who is in turn the serpent or the devil who offers knowledge. What kind of knowledge could they want? Maybe they want to know how to complete the New World Order Vice have started. Either way, Moloch or Minerva worship is satanic. They both have child sacrifice. They're wearing black, red, and white cloaks and practicing idol worship. This Minerva is Satan in disguise. The owl at the grove is further proof that the Illuminati lives on, since Vicep adopted the symbol of the owl from ancient Greece.
I am a happy member of the Bohemian Grove. I like the folks who come there, and it's really inappropriate for me to talk about the group beyond that.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
Frankly, I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about. You have this is what's called ambush journalism, and I disrespect you for that as well. So thank you and goodbye.
It's
none of your business.
Many people who attend the Bohemian Grove are on the news every day, leading double lives. Some of these people include George W. Bush, George H.W. Bush. Ronald Reagan and Richard Nixon were also members. Eisenhower attended. Master Harry S. Truman attended. Jimmy Carter attended. Newt Gingrich attends. Henry Kissinger attends. National Security Advisor Colin Powell, as well as Secretary of State George Shultz, were on their way to Bohemian Grove on this flight. Alan Greenspan attends. Prince Philip attends. Now just think, we have all these confirmed people photographed at the Grove. Just imagine how many people we don't have photographed that go there. All these people's associates, all these New World Order Bilderbergers, CFR people, Council on Foreign Relations people, Trilateral Commission people. There's probably thousands.
What do you want me to talk about? The Bohemian Club? As you say, the Bohemian Club? I've never been to the Bohemian Club, but you ought to go. It'd be good for you. Get some fresh air.
Here's a New Statesman news report that tells us that Bill Clinton has gone to the Bohemian Grove. Bill Clinton is a lying piece of garbage. Now, the Vatican is also involved. You see high-level Catholics go to the Bohemian Grove. Here's some cardinals and bishops. And here's a picture of a Catholic mass that was taken at the Grove. And more Catholics at the Grove. Here's an idolized 6-foot wooden carving of the club's patron saint, Saint John of Nepomuk, at the Grove. In fact, the Vatican is helping the Illuminati strive for a new world order, one world government. Pope John Paul II attended the Bilderberg meeting in Portugal in 1999. Bill Clinton and David Rockefeller were there as well. Then shortly after, Pope John Paul II calls for a new world order based on the goals of the United Nations. But the United Nations is an international joke. It always has been. Bilderberg is where the elite of the world meet up. Now the current Pope, Pope Benedict, has recently called for a new world order as well. He's saying, to fight terrorism and poverty, we must have a new world order. But you see, terrorism is exaggerated. That's order out of chaos, where you artificially create a crisis and then offer a solution to it to achieve your goal. That is also reverse psychological propaganda. Now let's get this straight really quick. The Catholic Church is not Christian. Okay, the Bible was written hundreds of years before the Council of Nicaea. Actually, the Vatican is anti-Christian because they do a lot of stuff that the Bible warns us not to do. On December 12, 1984, Los Angeles Times article, Pope John Paul II said the following, "Don't go to God for forgiveness of sins, come to me." You see, that goes directly against the Bible, the Word of God. Now the Bible says in Mark 2 verse 7, "Why does this man talk this way? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" It's a good question. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Certainly not some guy with a stick and a weird hat, that's for sure. You see, only God can forgive sins, not the Pope. The Pope is merely a man, like you or me. Now, the Bible made detailed prophecies about the end times, last days. Revelation 17 tells us about the great harlot of the end times. Verse 4 says, quote, "The woman wore purple and scarlet clothes, and was adorned with gold, gems, and pearls. In her hands she was holding a gold cup filled with detestable things and the impurities of her immorality," unquote. Verse 6 tells us, quote, "I saw the woman, or harlot, was drunk with the blood of the saints and the blood of the witnesses to Jesus. When I saw her, I wondered." The woman of Revelation 17 is obviously a church. The Bible often refers to churches as women. For example, in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 1 through 2, Ephesians 5, verse 23-24, and Acts 7, verse 38. In Revelation 17, verse 6, it tells us that this woman or church is a great persecuting church. She will persecute the true saints and Christians, also known as born-again believers in Christ, or born-again Christians. Well, how can the Vatican have all this power, you ask? Well, in Revelation 17, verse 18, in regard to the harlot's attributes, it says, quote, "And the woman which thou sawest is that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth." So it's saying the Vatican will control and have influence over the leaders of the world, which is exactly what we see.
Father, if you don't believe in Christ when you die, you are going to hell?
No, not at all. What about a rabbi who really follows the Lord as best he can? As a Catholic, I'm very comfortable that he attains salvation by doing this.
Christ, so he attains it without believing in Christ?
Correct.
And as a Catholic, how do you view Muhammad?
As a very wise man, I see the beauty of Islam in a very strong way.
The greatest conceivable being must also be all-loving, for it's obviously better to be loving than unloving. Therefore, God, as the morally perfect being, must be all-loving. And this is exactly what the Bible affirms. The Bible says, God shows his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. What a contrast when we read what the Quran says about God's attitude towards sinners. According to the Quran, God does not love sinners. Listen to the following passages. God loves not the unbelievers. God loves not evildoers. God loves not the proud. God loves not transgressors. God loves not the prodigal. God loves not the treacherous. God is an enemy to unbelievers. The Quran declares that God does not love the very people that the Bible said God loves so much that he sent his only son to die for them. God's love must be unconditional and impartial. Therefore, the Islamic conception of God seems to be morally inadequate.
Moving on. Now, for a long time, the Vatican was against Freemasonry and would excommunicate any Catholic who joined a lodge. This was in Canon Law 2335. But on November 27, 1983, Pope John Paul II issued Canon Law 1374, which replaced Canon Law 2335. This new canon law said the following: one who joins an association which plots against the Church is to be punished with a just penalty. One who promotes or moderates such an association, however, is to be punished with an interdict. Then that same year, Benedict, who was a cardinal, made a commentary to go with that new law, due to a confusion of the Vatican stance on Freemasonry, because 2335 said a Catholic will get excommunicated if he joins Freemasonry, but 1374 just says if you join a group that plots against the Church, you will have a penalty. Says nothing about Freemasonry, says nothing about excommunication. So Benedict made a deceitful smokescreen, but I caught it. He said if you join Masonry, you might not receive Holy Communion. You see, he tried to pass that off as excommunication, but there's a huge difference. See, in fact, if you are only denied communion, that is a huge jump from 2335 that says you're banned from the Church. This new law is meant to slowly allow Freemasonry into the Vatican. Very evil and deceitful. This new law has had an astounding effect on high-level Catholics in regard to the Freemasonry issue. Now, the Archdiocese of Los Angeles, in a letter from September 15, 2000, to the Masonic Service Bureau of North America, says, "It's a very complex yes or no answer if a Catholic can be a Mason due to this new law." He says, quote, "I believe the answer is probably yes to joining a lodge in the U.S. if you're Catholic." Then he says, it only says denial of communion in the new law, which is nothing. Then he says, there's no agreement among the experts in church law who have considered the matter. Then he references a book called The Evolution of the Church's Prohibition Against Catholic Membership in Freemasonry. So basically what this guy's saying is that the new canon law is slowly letting people become Masons who are Catholic. You see how Benedict and Pope John Paul II twisted everything? They said you might not receive Holy Communion, but that's nothing, okay? That's not excommunication. Big difference from the past canon law 2335 that said you're banned from the Church if you're a Mason. Here's a Catholic World News brief from March 5th, 2007, just last year. Bishop Garrodi says, quote, "Membership in a Masonic lodge is not necessarily grounds for excommunication." Then he says the same garbage about denial of communion host. You see what's going on? Here's a Catholic World News article, February 9th, 2007. It says, "Italian priest joins Masons. Father Rosario Francesco Esposito dismissed the Catholic Church ban on membership in the Freemasonic lodge, saying it's, quote, a thing of the past." Archbishop Telemayan Tugaguru is noted as being a high-level Freemason. Some 80% of Filipino Masons are Catholic. The fact is the Vatican is pro-Masonic, or else they wouldn't have made Canon Law 1374. They are also pro-New World Order, or else Pope John Paul II would not have attended Bilderberg, and the last two popes would not have called for a New World Order. The fact is the Vatican is indeed the great harlot of Revelation.
Earlier this week, two Arizona brothers filed a civil lawsuit in Chicago. That suit alleges McGuire molested the boys during confession between 1988 and 2002. Last year, McGuire was convicted of molesting two boys in the late 1960s. He was sentenced to 7 years in prison and 20 years of probation for that crime, but today is free on bond. The Jesuit order says they are cooperating with authorities and are deeply sorry.
"We are painfully aware that we have not done enough to prevent abuse of children and vulnerable adults, and that we have made mistakes by thinking that restrictive measures we undertook with regard to Donald McGuire would be effective. We failed to recognize behaviors that suggested abuse was occurring. More important, we failed to listen to those who came forward and to meet their courage in dealing with the problem that McGuire presented."
Activists with the Survivors Network of those abused by priests say an apology isn't good enough. McGuire should not be free.
Thank you.
So in review, I demonstrated the following things. The Illuminati spread after 1785 with the help of the Rothschilds. Freemasonry was infected by the Illuminati. The United States was infected with the Illuminati as early as 1798. Freemasonry wants New World Order, discovered in the Grand Orient Archives. Freemasonry is satanic. Illuminati and Freemasons control the New World Order. Freemasons kill whistleblowers. Illuminati elite and Freemasons attend Satanic Bohemian Grove. Vatican is involved with the Grove in the New World Order. Vatican is anti-Christian. Vatican is involved with the Freemasons. Now, some people believe that Christianity was created by the New World Order. In this last part of the film, I will show you why that is illogical, fallacious, and not accepted by real scholars. Films like Zeitgeist and books like Zeitgeist's main source, The Christ Conspiracy, talk of these kind of things. The first thing I will refute is the idea that Jesus is derived from mythological gods. Now, Mike Lacona made a critique on the book The Christ Conspiracy by Acharya S., which is Zeitgeist's main source. A lot of this next information comes from Lacona's critique, his sources, and my own research. Let's first look at Krishna. Is it true that Krishna is so similar to Jesus that Christianity must have borrowed from Hinduism? Well, Dr. Edwin Bryant, professor of Hinduism at Rutgers University, is a scholar on Hinduism. He has translated the Bhagavata Purana, or Life of Krishna, for Penguin World Classics, and is currently writing a book to be titled The Quest of Historical Krishna. In a response to the question of Krishna being crucified, Dr. Edwin Bryant replied, quote, "That is absolute and complete nonsense. There is absolutely no mention anywhere which alludes to a crucifixion," unquote. He also added that Krishna was killed by an arrow from a hunter who shot him in the heel. He died and there was no resurrection. He then stated that Acharya S. doesn't know what she's talking about. There are absolutely no Indian gods portrayed as crucified. Acharya S. claims there are 24 comparisons of Krishna to Jesus, while Dr. Edwin Bryant stated that 14 of her 24 comparisons are wrong, and the 15th is partially wrong. What about the other 9? Well, Benjamin Walker, in his book The Hindu World, an Encyclopedia Survey of Hinduism, states that there can be no doubt that the Hindus borrowed these 9 similarities from Christianity. Dr. Edwin Bryant, as well as many other scholars, note that these parallels come from the Bhagavata Purana, which is from the 7th to 11th century, way after the Gospels, and the Harivamsa, which is from the 4th to the 6th centuries, way after the Gospels. So in other words, these similarities to Christianity in the Hindu text do not appear until after the Gospels were already written. This means they borrowed from Christianity, and not vice versa. Acharya S. further claims that Christianity has failed in India because they've recognized Christianity as an imitation of their much older traditions. To this, Dr. Bryant simply commented, quote, "Stupid comment," unquote. Acharya's and Zeitgeist's claims that Christianity has borrowed substantially from Hinduism is without merit. Their claims are false, unsupported, and exhibit a lack of understanding in the Hindu faith. Next up is Buddha. Acharya lists 18 similarities. Mike Lacona emailed Professor Chu Fan Yu, chair of the Department of Religion at Rutgers University. Dr. Yu specializes in Buddhist studies. She simply said, quote, "None of the 18 are correct. A few, however, have some correctness, but are badly distorted," unquote. Dr. Yu said the following about Acharya S., quote, "The woman you speak of is totally ignorant of Buddhism. It is very dangerous to spread misinformation like this. You should not honor her by engaging in a discussion. Please ask her to take a basic course in world religion or Buddhism before uttering another word about things she does not know," unquote. Next is Horus. Now, Acharya and Zeitgeist say there's 18 similarities. Isis, Mary? No, it was Isis. There's no scholarly reference saying it was Isis, Mary. Anyway, Isis was Horus's mother, who was widowed to Osiris. Isis practiced magic to raise Osiris from the dead, putting pieces of his body back together. Once she did this, she became pregnant, and so on and so forth. She was not a virgin, she was widowed to Osiris, and had sex with his intact dead body, so there was no virgin birth. Crucifixion and resurrection, I could find no scholarly reference to support this claim. On the contrary, Horus is never said to have been crucified, nevertheless to have even died. There was no death and resurrection, but a merger of Horus and Osiris. And Osiris never resurrects, as he is forbidden to return to the world of the living. So no crucifixion, no resurrection. That is nonsense. December 25th, Horus's birth was on the 31st day of the Egyptian month Koyak. And the December 25th issue is of no relevance anyway. Nowhere does the New Testament associate this date with Jesus' birth. That was made up 500 years later.
As for the 12 disciples claim, neither I nor Miller nor any scholarly reference have found a reference for this claim. We find four semi-divine hero Shemzu, we find reference to 16 human followers and a group of Mensu who helped Horus in battle. We cannot find 12 disciples anywhere. And Horus is not the sun god, that's Ra, so we can't use the all solar gods have 12 disciples zodiac routine. Horus did not have 12 disciples, that's fiction. As for the Horus being born in a manger claim, scholarly references say Horus was born in a swamp, and no, nothing of a star or wise man of any number. The word S-U-N and S-O-N are only the exact same sounding in the English language, and Horus isn't even the sun god, so sun, S-U-N, is irrelevant. Zeitgeist has no logic. The following three claims have no merit in academic literature, and Egyptian scholars know nothing of them. The first one, child teacher at 12 in a temple. The second one, 30 was baptized, and then was baptized by Anup the Baptizer. These three are not substantiated by anyone. As for miracles, they are abundant among religious groups that could not possibly have influenced one another, such as Aztecs and Roman MRs, so this similarity carries no force. One supposed one was walking on water, which cannot be found in any scholarly literature. What can be found is he was thrown in the water, but he never walked on water. That's just nonsense. The mountaintop encounter? I will read both encounters, and you decide if you see causation. First, Jesus. Jesus completes his fast in the wilderness. Satan tempts Jesus to worship him. Jesus refuses. Now here's Horus's. During battle, Horus rips off Set's testicles, and Set rips out Horus's eye. They try to initiate intercourse to prove dominance. Horus catches Set's semen and then throws it in the river. Horus later masturbates, spreads his semen on lettuce, which Set consumes. They stand before the gods, and Horus is granted rule. How is that similar at all? Once you look into this stuff, it's just ridiculous. Acharya and Zeitgeist claim there's similar titles. They say Horus was known as Way, the Truth, the Light, Messiah, God's Anointed Son, Son of Man, Good Shepherd, Lamb of God, Word of Truth. Okay, first of all, I could not find any scholarly reference for these titles. What I did find was Great God, Chief of Powers, and Master of Heaven. So I think they just made those up to try and make a case. Look, we don't want to hear from Gerald Massey, who was shut down long ago and rejected. We want the original citation from Egyptian records. Massey is a secondary source, so show us your primary sources, Zeitgeist and Acharya, and make sure they're not subjective, because if they're subjective, your opinion is already going to be presupposed. So the difference between Jesus and Horus is enormous. And around 95% of these supposed similarities are pure fiction. The other 5% are subjective and can only be expected due to sheer probability. For example, there are many coincidences between Jesus and JFK. Which mystery gods actually experienced a resurrection from the dead? Certainly no early texts refer to any resurrection of Attis. Attempts to link the worship of Adonis to a resurrection are equally weak. Nor is the case for a resurrection of Osiris any stronger. After Isis gathered together the pieces of Osiris' dismembered body, he became Lord of the Underworld. And of course, no claim can be made that Mithras was a dying and rising god. French scholar André Boulanger concludes, "The conception that the god dies and is resurrected in order to lead his faithful to eternal life is represented in no Hellenistic mystery religion. Not one clear case of any alleged resurrection teaching appears in any pagan text before the late 2nd century AD, almost 100 years after the New Testament was written. Parallels between the pagan myths of dying and rising gods and the New Testament accounts of the resurrection of Jesus are now regarded as remote, to say the least. If anyone borrowed any ideas from anyone, it seems it was the Gnostics who took up Christian ideas. The first real parallel of a dying and rising god does not appear until AD 150, more than 100 years after the origin of Christianity. So if there is any influence of one or the other, it was the influence of the historical event of the New Testament resurrection on mythology, not the reverse. We find almost no trace of cults of dying and rising gods in first century Palestine. Moreover, as Hans Grass observes, it would be unthinkable in any case that the original disciples would come sincerely to believe that God had raised Jesus from the dead just because they had heard myths about Osiris. Acharya S. and Zeitgeist also claim that astrology played a large role in the formation of the Christian Church. Mike Lacona emailed Dr. Noel Swerdlow, professor of astronomy and astrophysics at the University of Chicago. This is his response to Zeitgeist's view. The modern ideas about the age of Pisces or the age of Aquarius are based upon the location of the vernal equinox in the regions of the stars of those constellations. But the regions, the borders between those constellations, are a completely modern convention of the International Astronomical Union for the purpose of mapping and never had any astrological significance. I hope this is helpful, although in truth, what this woman is claiming is so wacky that it is hardly worth answering. So when this woman says the Christian fish was a symbol of the coming age of Pisces, she is saying something that no one would have thought of in antiquity, because in which constellation of the fixed stars of the vernal equinox was located was of no significance and is entirely an idea of modern, I believe 20th century astrology. In other words, these supposed ancient Christ conspirators could not have recognized the 12 celestial sections in order to incorporate them into a Christian myth and usher in the age of Pisces, as Zeitgeist claims, because the division into the celestial sections did not occur until a meeting of the International Astronomical Union in the 20th century. Therefore, these claims are debunked. In the Christ conspiracy, Acharya also claims that Hebrews were moon worshippers, therefore that gives merit to her argument. She provides a biblical reference out of context for this claim. She cites Isaiah chapter 66 verse 22 to 24. Here is the verse out of context, which she used. And here it is, in its proper context. These verses do not speak of moon worship. Rather, as time goes on, all mankind will worship the Lord, the creator of the heavens and the earth. In Isaiah 47, verse 13 through 14, God is warning, not the Hebrews, but the Babylonians, who are astrologers and moon worshippers, that if they don't stop, they will be destroyed. This just shows the deliberate dishonesty of Zeitgeist's camp. It is abundantly clear why real scholars have not acknowledged Acharya's and Zeitgeist's views. Almost all other sources are secondary and wrong most of the time. A large number of their sources are not even real scholars, and they make wild claims without supporting them. Now that I laid the criteria for Christianity not being derived from myths, I will demonstrate how the New World Order's plan is to destroy Christianity and to make a New Age One World Religion. Alice Bailey wrote a book called Externalization of the Hierarchy. She was head of Lucius Trust, formerly known as Lucifer Publishing. It was a publishing company for the United Nations. David Rockefeller is part of Lucius Trust Management. Alice Bailey's book, Externalization of the Hierarchy, spells out the plan for the Satanists and New Agers on how the demonic hierarchy or New World Order will externalize their rule over the planet. The book gives away details of the plan but tries to make it sound somewhat appealing to deceived minds. The book explains how the New Age One World Religion, One World Government will be brought in. Alice Bailey tells us who will rule this New World Order and this New World Religion. She notes it will be the Lord of the World, or the new ruler of the world, which we Christians know to be Satan. On page 107, they even admit it's Lucifer who will be given rule. It also says there will be a new Christ, as we Christians call the Antichrist. On page 511, 512, it says the three vehicles which will be used to bring in the new religion will be the Freemasonic lodges, the infiltration of the churches like the Catholic Church, and the education system. Essentially, she revealed, in place of Christianity, the mystery religions will be restored by the Church and the Freemasons and the education system. They are fulfilling Revelation. If Christianity was a New World Order tool, why would they want to replace it with a New Age religion? The fact is, Jesus predicted these things that are taking place in our lifetime and told us to resist the Antichrist system and to deny the mark of the beast. Now, the Rockefellers have contributed to many anti-Christian organizations. The Federal Council of Churches was financed by the Rockefellers. The FCC was designed to destroy Christianity. On January 31, 1945, John D. Rockefeller addressed the Protestant Council in New York City and told them that the answer to the problems of Christianity was that Christianity needed to become the Church of the Living God. The God of the elite, or their living God, is actually Lucifer, as Alice Bailey noted. Now, Weissep's goal was to destroy Western civilization and to erect a new world order ruled by them. Its method was to dissolve all social ties to nations, religion, race, and family, by exploiting social discontent and promising a golden age of human brotherhood, secular humanism, and eventually full globalization. We see this unfolding in front of our very eyes, except over the years the Illuminati New World Order adopted Satanism and became demonic. The purpose of the New World Order is to literally enslave mankind. These Luciferians portray the rebellion against God with the disguise of progress and freedom.
I think I am an agent of change. I embody change.
They are divorcing humanity from the truth of Jesus Christ and replacing the holy truth with a Luciferian New Age One World Government fascist system. Under the disguise of humanist utopia, they are ushering in an Antichrist Satanic Empire beast system predicted in the Bible 2,000 years ago, before this group was even around. The Lucifer Trust runs the only chapel at the United Nations, and instead of having a statue of Jesus Christ, the true God of the universe, in the United Nations building, they have a statue of the false god Zeus. The elite hate Jesus. They hate the truth. Don't you find it striking that the atheist New World Order researchers who are supposedly exposing the big Christ conspiracy get to make books, they get to go in films, go in television, go in documentaries and make all this money, like Acharya S., Peter Joseph, the creator of Zeitgeist, Jordan Maxwell, and David Icke, while the Christian New World Order researchers who expose the Satanic Empire and inform the people of the truth of Christianity get killed and jailed, such as William Cooper, John Todd, Fritz Springmeier, Philip Schneider. Why do the atheists get all the publicity and attention? You know why? Because it's orchestrated like that. We are being prepared in consciousness for slavery and destruction. The Illuminati's main purpose is to eliminate God. It is my philosophical belief that the elite know God and Satan are real, and they think if they can get enough people on Satan's side, they can beat Jesus in the inevitable final battle of Armageddon due to the overwhelming amount of prophecies that came true in the Bible. The elite control all major media and they silence anyone who opposes their satanic humanist doctrine. They have conditioned the people to short-circuit at the mention of Jesus. They have decisively made God seem mysterious, unknowable, or non-existent. This was Satan's plan from the very beginning, to deceive the whole world. In Revelation 13, verse 16 through 17, John made a specific prophecy about the mark of the beast. It says, quote, "And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark on their right hand or their foreheads, and that no man will be able to buy or sell unless he have the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name," unquote. What this means is the beast system will force everyone to receive a device on their hand or their forehead, and if they don't take it, they will not be able to buy food, pay rent, or live a normal life. Revelation 14 verse 10 tells the Christians not to accept this mark no matter what. Peter taught to obey God rather than these men. In the Gospel of John, Jesus referred to Satan as the ruler of this world, and that Satan is our enemy. The data I have put together points to this conclusion. 2,000 years ago, Jesus lived, was crucified, and resurrected. He sent his followers visions and prophecies of the future that are coming true today, such as a one-world government, a beast system, persecution of Christianity, mark of the beast system, and with this new world order system, it is now possible for a man to rule the entire world and proclaim himself to be God. If you believe the Bible is a conspiracy, your belief holds no weight, as I have demonstrated. It is up to the individual to decide whether he or she wants to believe.